Thank you very much for that kind introduction, Shannon. And you should never applaud before you've heard what I'm going to say. You might want to take your applause back. We shall reserve judgment. So my job here is to give a sort of macro level bird's eye view sense of the trends in organized violence and violent conflict on the continent over the last couple of decades or so. I'll focus mainly on the period since the 1990s or so. And as Shannon's mentioned, I'll give a sense of what sort of the academic and open source data indicates are the major trends that are going on. And then I'll think sort of secondly, politically, what are the different types of organized violence that we see? And we're seeing obviously a very broad spectrum from sort of organized criminal activity, popular protests, right through to sort of counterinsurgency and traditional civil wars. And then finally, I want to think a little bit about the political drivers and the different drivers of organized violence on the continent and go from there. And I suppose the top level conclusion, as I see it at least, is if you look at the continent at that macro level for the last 30 years or so, after a really bad period in the early and middle 1990s, the continent improved on pretty much every indicator to do with violent conflict through to the mid-2000s. And I think, you know, a combination of mediation efforts, peace operations and other things were pushing things in the right direction. But from about 2011 or so onwards, so the last 7, 8, 9 years or so now, most of the trend lines have been starting to go in the opposite, worrying, rising direction again. And so that's the context I want to sort of start off talking about. And the data that I've drawn here is just a chart that's from the Political Instability Task Force. This is an organization, a mix of government, US government personnel and academics, who have plotted the different types of organized violence on the continent. This is just showing ethnic wars, revolutionary wars, traditional civil wars, we might put it, political and politicized and genocidal violence on the continent, and also adverse regime changes, which is mainly coup d'etat. And as you see here, looking from 1950s to 2017, that tells the story that I've just mentioned. Yeah? From the peak of armed conflict and violent episodes in the 1990s, Africa recovered quite considerably into the early 2000s. But just in the last 8 or 9 years or so, we've started to see the trend lines increase. Now, if that was what the data shows us in terms of the temporary trends and chronological trends, what do we look like in terms of the spatial location of organized violence on the continent? And here, this source is drawn from ACLED, the Armed Conflict Event Location and Event Data organization. ACLED is very useful because it's all open source. It's based on media reportage and some independent research efforts. But the great thing about ACLED is they make all their data available within 2 weeks. So you can go to the ACLED website and find data available to just the last 2 weeks, whereas most of the data sets run on annual years. Now, ACLED also geolocate all the events. So if you're looking for geospatial analysis or to actually look at the spatial configurations of violence, ACLED is a very useful source to go to. And what I put up here is a chart that shows the 21st century, basically. And it shows three types of violence. Battles, self-explanatory, organized violence against civilians, and then thirdly, what ACLED calls remote violence, the light blue category. Remote violence is a combination of things like aerial bombardments, artillery bombardments, but also improvised explosive devices. It's any violence that can be done remotely, as the name suggests. And if you put those three categories of violence together, you'll see the story of the 21st century in the continent is that, broadly speaking, southern Africa has got a lot more peaceful. And the good news story is clearly from the 1990s, the southern part of the continent. But the majority of the violence we're going to be focusing on now and probably in the immediate future is in the band from the Sahel across to the Horn in particular. Now, the bringing things right up to date, this is again using ACLED data, but now just focusing on the period 1st of January 2018 through to the middle of May 2019. And I've added in here as well popular protests, because I think one of the things we want you to think about, obviously, is the broad continuum of conflict. Civil wars, insurgencies, coups don't spring from a political vacuum. They grow from already existing conflict trends. And one of the best signals of those, of course, is political protests, when people take to the streets, not necessarily in violent protests, but ACLED also monitors non-fatality or non-violent episodes of conflict. So this is the map of the continent you see there for the last year and a half, factoring in popular political protests. And again, the story is a bit broader, but it's clearly that the belt from the Sahel through to the Horn. And then obviously, if you're interested in Libya and, well, Libya in particular, there's a North African dimension to this too. Now, if we think about not just the numbers of armed conflict, but we think about actually the levels of fatality, how many people are being killed as a result of these armed conflict? What I've put up on this chart here is data from the Uppsala Conflict Data Program. I've tried to choose basically data from what I think are the three most useful data sets for you to use in your work. So I think the Political Instability Task Force, ACLED, and then the Uppsala Conflict Data Program. If you familiarize yourselves with those three organizations' websites, I think you'll have a pretty good set of data to work with in terms of understanding conflict trends. Now, what Uppsala count here are what they call battle-related deaths and one-sided violence. So battle-related deaths are any soldiers or civilians that are killed in or around battles. That could be collateral damage, civilians killed accidentally, or it could be the result of soldiers fighting. And then the second category is what they call one-sided violence. This is massacres, in effect. This is where armed groups, rebels, government soldiers, or whoever deliberately massacre non-combatants and civilians. And then the third category you'll see there is non-state fatalities. Non-state is the category that Uppsala uses for when you have a war and you have battles, but you don't have a government taking part as one of the conflict parties. So this would be, say, two warlord factions fighting in Somalia, or maybe pastoral communities fighting in the Abyei region between South Sudan and Sudan. That would classify as non-state armed violence, all the characteristics of war, but not a government army or government soldiers involved. And as you can see here again, in terms of battle-related deaths, it's a pretty positive story across the continent for the last decade and a half. Compared to the levels of the 1990s and early 2000s, the number of battle-related fatalities has dropped dramatically. Now, this chart that I've got here actually excludes the Rwandan genocide, because in the next one, if you put the Rwandan genocide figures into the rest of the continent, it dwarfs every other event. Obviously, the majority of people in Rwanda's genocide were killed as part of one-sided violence. These were civilians massacred, obviously, separate from the civil war dynamics. So just a reminder, that chart is showing it without Rwanda's genocide, so it looks like there's been quite a lot of variation. But if you factor Rwanda in, everything else is basically very small. Now, it's not all good news, because what this doesn't include is war deaths. This is only focusing on the people that are killed through organized violence. And one of the other things that the data reveals is that the vast majority of people in Africa who die from organized warfare do not die violent deaths. They're dying from disease and malnutrition-related problems. I think it's the war in the Democratic Republic of Congo that has the most stark statistic here. Only about 2% of people in the wars in the DR Congo were killed in organized violence, in battles. The vast majority for others were dying from the effects of forced displacement, malnutrition, disease, and other things. So these data sets don't show you war deaths, they just show you battle deaths. And the war deaths count is a much more complicated, and frankly, we don't have accurate data for that. Now, if that's the brief trends, how should we think about these different types of conflict politically and in terms of what's going on socially? Here I would say that I think of them at least in terms of a typology of seven different types of things that are going on the continent. The first is the traditional distinction, obviously, between civil wars and intrastate armed conflicts and interstate conflicts. The trouble with the category of intrastate wars, of course, is that they never stay intrastate. although we call them internal, I don't think there's ever been an internal war that stayed internal. Armed factions and conflict parties either get political support, financial support, armament support, recruit and fighter support from outside the war. So we use the category of intrastate armed conflict, but it doesn't mean it stays hermetically sealed within the country. The second category, obviously, is when states fight one another. And Africa, as you'll know better than me, traditionally actually has relatively few interstate wars compared to most other regions of the world. The problem with this category, of course, is that it ignores proxy wars. While African governments don't often explicitly fight one another overtly, there's a lot of occasions where African governments will covertly support an insurgency or rebel group in somebody else's country. So in effect, you've got a political conflict between the states, but they don't fight with their own troops on the battlefield. The third category is the one I just explained, non-state armed conflicts. This is where you have all the characteristics of warfare, you know, organized parties engaging in battles and violence against one another, but it doesn't include a government. And so the main groups that would fit into non-state armed conflict would be, I said, Somalia, for example, clan-based conflicts or warlord factions fighting one another, or different types of tribal or pastoralist communities fighting over resources. That's the category of non-state. And so the way I think of it, at least, is you've got sort of two worlds of conflict in Africa. There's the conflict based around the state system, and there's sort of the set of conflicts that are based around African states, sovereignty, and organized violence in that sense. And then there's the non-state world, conflicts that don't involve Africa's governments. And if you want the numbers, from 1990 until about today, Africa has experienced about 650 of these types of conflicts. About 650. Of that 650, about 100 or so are in the state world. About 100 or so involve government forces and traditional rebels. But about 500 or so is this non-state category of armed conflict. So it's very important to remember the numbers here. Now, the non-state armed conflicts don't kill as many people. They're not as large, but they are far more numerous. They also take place in really just a handful of African countries. Nigeria, Ethiopia, Somalia, Sudan and South Sudan, and the Democratic Republic of Congo account for well over three quarters of all of the continent's non-state armed conflicts. Then you've got the category of one-sided violence. This is where massacres, genocide, ethnic cleansing fits in. And of course, most of those episodes of one-sided violence are related to a civil war or a conflict of some sort. They don't spring up from nowhere, but they're counted often as a separate category for the data set purposes. Then I think it's important to distinguish these things from military coup d'etat. Africa, obviously, from the 1960s has been the sort of global epicenter of coups, but it has a relatively, I would say, sort of positive trends in the last couple of decades where we've seen much fewer military coups. But if you follow Africa since about 2003 onwards, there's actually been a bit of a rise again. And obviously the African Union, as we can maybe talk about, has got a very different position on responding to coups now than the old Organization of African Unity. Then penultimately, I think there's a series of conflicts and new databases that are collecting evidence about electoral violence. These are all the types of armed conflict that are related to electoral campaigns. That's not limited just to sort of violence on voting day. The category of electoral violence will be whenever a party uses coercion or intimidation and uses violence as part of that, and that can be anywhere throughout the whole electoral campaign cycle. In fact, most of it will come early on, and by the time we get to voting day, there's normally less of the violence. Here, the evidence is very strongly that most of the violence around elections are used by incumbent governments against opponents. It's very heavily, in data terms, the incumbent governments that are wielding most of the electoral-related violence. And then finally, what I've called livelihood struggles is basically the story about climate change and environmental degradation on the continent. Livelihood struggles is what an American professor, Scott Strauss, has labeled these types of conflicts. What I'm talking about here are normally very localized armed struggles, either to do with pastoralism as a lifestyle between pastoralist communities and more sedentary agricultural communities, or it's to do with fighting that is about access to water, land, grazing for livestock, but generally very sort of localized struggles there. And it's to do increasingly with changes in the environment and the uncertainties and the problems around them. So for me, at least, when I look at all that data and the trends and the maps and what have you, I think it's normally one of those, or a combination of those seven different types of conflict that you see. And then finally, sort of, how should we make sense of all this politically? Why is this happening? What are the key drivers here? What I put on the left-hand side of this slide, you'll see my dark clouds, if you like. The dark clouds are what I think are the major sort of popular ideas and arguments that explain warfare in Africa. And I think you'll find six big ones, basically. The first argument is basically to blame things on colonial legacies. Right, you can all think of the arguments here. This is about either arbitrary borders being imposed, splitting up or pushing together ethnic and tribal and other groups. It's about the strategy of divide and rule and trying to put certain local groups above others and creating political inequalities, about creating infrastructure that was about extracting economic resources, not bringing people together. You can all think of a long list, yeah, of colonial legacies, but one set of arguments will say Africa is still experiencing basically the colonial legacies and the problems, and that explains a lot of the wars. A second argument you'll find is a sort of the exact opposite in one sense. It puts the blame mostly not on the colonial period, but on Africa's first generation or sometimes second generation of post-colonial elites. This argument will point to a bunch of presidents who came to power through national liberation struggles, but then didn't relinquish power, and as a result generated a whole second wave of insurgencies and civil wars because they were repressive in their own right. And so that puts a focus very much more on domestic governance rather than colonial types of governance structures. You'll then have, thirdly, I think, it's all about the rebels, right? The third argument is that we can explain most conflicts because of their greedy warlords, as I put it there. These conflicts are being driven not by states or governments, but it's the rebels' fault. It's people that want to make a lot of money out of controlling violently access to diamond mines, oil fields, timber, resources, whatever the case may be. But it's driven by greedy individuals who want to use war to further their financial interests, in effect. A fourth set of arguments you'll find is to do with ethnicity. And I think, sadly, Africa probably gets, in terms of the global picture here, more explanations of this sort than any other region of the world. And that the argument is, in effect, it's ethnic differences and tribal differences or clan differences that are really driving conflict on the continent. Fifth, I think I need to mention it, although it's not been most prominent for a long time, is the clash of civilizations argument made famous or infamous by American professor Samuel Huntington. This didn't feature heavily for a long time, but particularly after 9/11 and the growing explicitly religious dimensions and theocratic dimensions of armed conflict in the last couple of decades since then, there's been a sort of resurgence of thinking of what he called fault line conflicts, arguments and fighting because of our religious and theological differences. And then finally, you'll find a lot of literature about what I'm going to call resource wars, right? A lot of the conflicts in Africa are being fought over control of mineral resources, energy sources, those types of things. Now, in my opinion, those six are largely mythical and largely, I think, sort of secondary factors. And for me, in my opinion, the key issues that are driving most of these conflicts are the three that I put on the right-hand side. In a word, it's about politics, I think. And if you want a more sort of elaborate, or three words, it's the combination of governance-related issues, sovereignty-related issues and actually protecting and empowering regimes and keeping regimes in power, and natural resources. And so I just want to explain a little bit about that to finish. By governance, I mean, I think all of the conflicts, those 650 or so that I mentioned before, there's always violence when our governance and our political mechanisms can't solve our conflicts peacefully. So for me, it's never a story of sort of, there's no such thing as an apolitical war. War has always got political and governance related grievances at the bottom of it, whether that's a war between pastoralist groups or it's a traditional civil war or interstate war. So the grievances, the injustices that are generated by bad and repressive and oppressive systems of governance are always to be found underneath these conflicts. But to make it a little bit more complicated, there's an important dimension of sovereignty here. And what I mean by that is there's still a lot of conflicts, I think, in Africa where people are fighting because they think they're being ruled by foreigners. They're not happy with their current leadership or rulers. Now, that's not just European colonial legacies now. It's obviously more that groups are interested in self-determination in one form or another. So you could think about the Somalilanders, the Kabindans, the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic, previously the Eritreans or South Sudanese, the Tuaregs in Mali. There's lots of different groups around the continent that feel like they're oppressed by foreign groups of some description. So a lot of the political and governance questions actually end up being about self-determination and sovereignty, and how and whether we should preserve central regimes or decentralize regions and make more autonomous forms of government. And then the third factor that I think is key here is resources. But I want to be clear about what I mean by this. I don't think natural resources cause wars. And they certainly don't cause it in Africa or anywhere in the world. Just because there is oil underground or diamonds or gold underground, that doesn't cause humans to fight. So the presence of natural resources doesn't cause anything to do with war. It's about the politics of either sharing the wealth around those resources or the sort of inequalities or the felt injustices that come about their distribution. But what resources do affect is the dynamics of warfare. They are massively important in shaping where we fight and how we fight. So you couldn't understand, obviously, the violence in Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo at the moment without understanding where the mineral mines are. And so resources affect the dynamics, but they don't cause the problems. The one exception, or the question mark that I will put out now, is the whole issue to do with environmental changes. And I do think, from my reading of the literature about climate change and environmental degradation, if there is any type of resources that are actually starting to be triggers for war themselves, it is questions now, I think, of land, water, and the sort of nexus between pastoralist lifestyle, livestock type of nomadic groups. There, I think, at a very localized level, you can see the environmental issues starting to cause real problems at local community level. But again, people don't just fight because the weather is changing or the climate is changing. They fight when the arguments that those things produce can't get settled peacefully. And they can't get settled peacefully because our governance systems and our political systems don't work. And so that's why I mesh these three things together. For me, it's all about politics. There's no such thing as apolitical wars or apolitical conflicts. And ultimately, I think if you want to understand what's driving these things, you can talk a little bit about ethnicity and greedy warlords and colonial legacies, but it's really our contemporary political systems that are generally responsible for most of these trends, I think. And it's about ultimately reforming those political systems. Just two words, because I was asked to speak a little bit about the future, just to put things on the table for debate. One is about how we end wars on the continent. And I think you guys are going to have to think really seriously in your careers about how we can end the types of wars we see now, the big ones, right, with Al-Shabaab involved, with Boko Haram or Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb. What would the end of those wars look like? What would a peace deal or a political settlement between the Nigerian government and Boko Haram, or between the federal government in Somalia and Al-Shabaab, what would that look like? What would the issues have to be that we have to address on paper and deal with? There's been a tendency after 9/11 to not negotiate with terrorists, right? This has been largely a US-led foreign policy decision. We don't want to negotiate with terrorists. And after 9/11, we've called a lot of people we don't like terrorists. And it's meant that negotiating an end to civil wars has sort of shrunk. But I would just remind us, you know, you by definition, you don't negotiate an end to wars with your friends, you negotiate an end to war with your enemies. And so we've got to talk with our enemies. So that's debate number one I would throw out there. Secondly, is what does all this mean for the world of peace operations? And where do peacekeeping operations and peace operations as an attempt to sort of dampen down the worst consequences of war, what does this mean for peacekeeping? And linked to that first point, if we've got no end to war, if we can't think of how we're going to come to a political end, are we just going to keep doing peace operations forever? What is the exit strategy of the peace operations in Mali, for example, or Eastern DR Congo, or South Sudan? How are we going to finish these types of things? So I don't have good answers, but I would like to talk about maybe some of those things later on. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah.